There's no question that a lot of romanticism is dark, and that starts right with the use of the full chromatic scale. C, C sharp, D, D sharp, E, F, F sharp, G, G sharp, A, A sharp, B, C. And on the way down in flats, C, B, B flat, A, A flat, G, G flat, F, E, E flat, D, D flat, C. You can hear some of this creepiness in Schubert's Symphony No. 8, subtitled Unfinished. Only two movements rather than the usual four. And for a fairly large romantic orchestra, it's still evolving, but this one of two flutes, two oboes, two clarinets, two bassoons, two trumpets, got a pattern here, two French horns, and three trombones, timpani, and then the full strings. Of course, it's not all dark. Sometimes it's downright cheery, and given the fact that we're dealing with romanticism, it can be over-the-top cheery, or maybe excessively noble, as you'll find in the beginning of this Schubert's ninth and final symphony. He writes nine symphonies, and then he dies. Got another pattern? You like that ambiguity of do, re, mi, la, ti, do, or is it me, fa, so, do, re, me? Well, probably not, but it's the same kind of ambiguities that go all the way back to the Renaissance. And as a matter of fact, speaking of the Renaissance, our next guy channels that romantic, Renaissance-y William Shakespeare again. And he's another prodigy, another connection from the past, particularly classical, but really goes all the way back to medieval too. The obsession with talent, can't beat it. And indeed, Felix Mendelssohn was perceived in his day to be even more talented than Mozart. Thank you. picture to A Midsummer Night's Dream. So Mendelssohn looks back to Shakespeare in the Renaissance, but he also looks back to the Baroque. As a matter of fact, he's instrumental in rediscovering for his peers the music of Johann Sebastian Bach. And so in some ways, the Romantic era seems to be embracing the whole history of music up to this point, at least insofar as Europe is concerned, but they're going to start branching out to the rest of the world too, so stay tuned. Meanwhile, he's a fairly conservative composer. He's using sonata allegro form in that particular overture. Oh, and he also writes a whole suite of music for the Midsummer Night's Dream much later in his life. He does that first movement at about age 18, and then does a suite of instrumental music for an actual production of the play. And instrumental music is another form of program music, and we'll see that, you know, that will actually lead to television and movie music eventually. And many of those composers are, like Mendelssohn, kind of on the conservative side. And we're going to see, as mentioned before, this kind of split, definitely the split between the, shall we say, the liberal and the conservative romantic composers. And here's one of those liberals, following the lines of Berlioz, who we looked at last week. And this is Chopin, who is a Frenchman, but actually someone of Polish descent. He's working in France, which is, of course, in Paris, in this hotbed of new music, and he's going to be dark and chromatic to beat the band. First in this little selection, thanks to Monty Python, an orchestration, or shall we say a bandstration, of Chopin's Piano Sonata No. 2, third movement. And like other composers in the Romantic era, a musical specialist. He never met a piano he didn't like. And a piano virtuoso. Another one of these talented folks that can move those fingers across the keyboard, as in this slightly earlier work, the Fantasy Impromptu.